is an important task for bacterial genetics as well as in perspective of human genetics also. Because if you look at the chromosomal basis of inheritance, you know that the chromosome segments swap between themselves to generate variety, because this is the only way to generate variety during the process of cell division there. As well as also not the only way, but because there are also the arrangement of chromosomes which plays another important role. But the DNA recombination is not only important for generating the variety, but also recombination helps in the DNA repair in some cases. Recombination helps in DNA repair, especially the double-stranded break repair of the DNA. Here, I'll not be talking about any DNA repair systems because not that much important, but double-stranded break is an important repair mechanism. If you understand DNA recombination, the homologous DNA recombination very well, you all already kind of know the DSB also, so that's not a big deal. So the recombination process, for understanding the recombination, you should know the basic of chromosomes there. You know, I've already talked about those things earlier. I'm talking about them again. That, see, the chromosomes that we get from here, say one from the mother, one and another from the father. So let's say this is from the mother and this is from the father. So from the mother, that chromosome duplicates because during the process of cell division, the chromosome should be duplicated, the genetic content should be duplicated. So here, this is from the mother, and then now two chromatids are there, right? They are joined with a centromere out there. Centromere is a portion, a specialized structure that is designed to be interacting with the microtubules during the cell division and chromosome segregation. So see, the origin, these two DNA segments, these two chromatids, the origin of these two chromatids are maternal, same. So we call them homologous or sister chromatids. We call them sister chromatids. So those two chromatids from the father origin are sister chromatids of each other. Chromatids from the mother origin are called as the sister chromatids of each other. Now if I take one chromatid from the mother origin and compare with another chromatid of the father origin, those two will be termed as non-sister chromatids because they are of the different origins. Okay. Now crossing over take place between non-sister chromatids. Remember, because if we compare the sister chromatids, they will be exactly the same. There won't be any genetic difference there. But if you see two non-sister chromatids, there will be some genetic differences, right? Because they are from the different origins. So there are genetic differences there. So see, that's why they swap segment between this non-sister chromatids, right? See, after this swapping is done here. So during the swapping of the segment, those two chromosomes must be aligned properly. And the structure that they produce here is called the tetrad. Because there are four chromatids that are interacting. Two from mother origin, two from father origin. It's called a tetrad. And a specific structure that is formed, it looks something like this. Just like the chi letter. So you call it a chiasma. This particular structure, X-like structure, is called as a chiasma there. And chiasma has a particular point where exactly crossing over take place. That means where exactly both of the chromosomes break apart and they are rejoined. That point is known as crossover point, right? That's in the middle of that chiasma. It is the crossover point. Okay. Now this crossover point and this whole process of chromosome segregation, chromosome swapping and then segregation. This process is also known as the crossing over. It's also known as crossing over during the cell division, and this thing occurs in meiosis. One, crossing over occurs during the meiosis one, because remember this is the only phase, meiosis one, where mother and father chromatids are separated. Because in meiosis two, those sister chromatids will be segregated. That's it. But in meiosis one, the non-sister chromatids are separated. That's why this whole process occurs in meiosis 1. There are two different models of the recombination mainly. One is called the holiday model. Another one is the homologous recombination model that we know of. The holiday model states the process a little bit differently. It's not entirely correct. It was based on the discoverer of that pathway. But it's not exactly good, or it does not explain everything clearly. 1 minute. So see, these are the so we are not going to talk about the holiday model here. We'll be talking about directly to the homologous recombination process. So in homologous recombination, the idea, remember, we see the image for the chromosomal segment change. That seems very fair according to our eye, just one part swapped with another. But actually, when we look for the DNA level, it is quite different. It is quite difficult also, because the process starts with several different stages actually, and it involves multiple enzymes. The holiday model does not explain the process with enzymes. According to the holiday model, the whole process works without any polymerase enzyme. So the holiday model has some flaws. That's why we do not explain that nowadays. The actual model of homologous recombination starts with a double-stranded break in one of the genes, right? Let's say these are the two different non-homologous DNA, right? The non-sister, non-homologous, right? They are homologous, but they are non-sister. Non-sister chromatids, okay? So, in among one of the non-sister chromatids, everyone, is the voice clear? Is my voice clear? Okay, no problem. Say, the non-sister chromatids align, and one of the non-sister chromatids have a double-stranded break. And this is the initiation of the homologous recombination. While we have another intact strand of the DNA. Okay. Now the idea here is that one strand remains, one DNA remains intact, another has a double-stranded break. Now the second stage of it is called the strand invasion. Okay. And the preparation for strand invasion. The second part is that upon the double-stranded break, see, there are two different segments followed. I mean, they are blunt end in this case. But for this process to work properly, we need a 3' overhang in both this end, 3' overhang. And 3' overhang is generated. How and every detail we'll be studying in the next slides, but this is an overview. After generation of the 3' overhang, that one of the 3' overhang inserts itself to the intact DNA strand. It finds one strand as a template and place itself and find the complementary base pairing there. This process is called as strand invasion, because this 3' overhang strand invades this other strand, invade the other strand and place itself there. After the strand invasion, both the ends, strand invasion occur from both the sides here, okay. Then the process called the branch migration, because see, wherever we have a strand invasion, we have a structure like this, which looks like chiasma. This is kind of structure which we talk about, chiasma or crossing over points. So this is the crossing over points. So once two of the crossing over points can form one or twice. See, there are two different crossing over points formed here. And those are called the branch point also. Branch point for the crossing over. Then this process called the branch migration, where those branch point will migrate in the opposite directions like that. The branch migration will take place. After the branch migration is done, then the final stage is called the resolution of holiday junction, because the particular structure that formed here, if you look at the structure properly, it looks something like this, because this is a structure which are interwinding between one another. But if you open that up, it will look something like this. Those are the bonds formed like this. This kind of four-way structure, we call it a holiday junction. The final stage is the resolution of that holiday junction, that is the cleavage from this point, so that we find the two different DNA strands generated. See, these are the different stages, and this is the final stage, or the holiday junction resolution. This stage ultimately defines whether we are going to have the recombinant product or we are going to have the non-recombinant product. So let's look at them in details. So from the beginning, it starts with a double-stranded break And then after the double-stranded break, this slide explains about the different enzymes that we require mainly. After the double-stranded break, we add enzyme complex called RecBCD. Because in this case, we are looking at this process of recombination in E. coli. In E. coli, we have a RecBCD system. That RecBCD, B, C and D, different proteins, okay? They interact with each other and call the RecBCD complex. This RecBCD complex load itself to the end of this blunt end. RecBCD complex load itself. And then what will happen? This RecBCD complex had two different functions. One is the exonuclease function. Okay. Mainly, it has an exonuclease function. So, it can cleave from this terminal region, from both the terminal region. Okay. As well as the helicase activity. So, RecBCD start to unwind this DNA a little bit and then slowly start to chew the fragments of the DNA. So, it will slowly start to chew the fragment from both the ends. And after this RecBCD complex reaches a specific location, then it stops cleaving the fragment from the 3' end but increase the chewing activity from the 5' end. So, ultimately, they will lead to the generation of 3' overhang. Right? This is the job of RecBCD. Once the 3' overhang is generated, then it brings another protein called RecA. Very small protein. And this protein can interact with 3 nucleotide sequence at once. It covers this whole single-stranded DNA, the 3' overhang DNA completely covers it. And then bring one of the strand and place it properly in the intact DNA. And this RecA protein helps in the strand invasion. Once that is done, then the protein called RavA and B, two different proteins again, RavA and RavB, they help in migration of that branch point because they have a structure of helicase. They are kind of hexameric protein structure like helicase. They will help this branch point to move at a particular direction. And after that is done, after the migration is done properly, and new strands are synthesized by the polymerase, then another protein called RavC joins in for the holiday junction resolution activity. Remember, I have told about the different stages. Now we are talking about the enzymes that are involved in those stages. The holiday junction resolution, that is the cleavage of the junction from here or from here, brought about by RavB, and then the DNA ligase will join the nick and we have one parental DNA and another recombinant type of DNA. Okay. And now imagine if we have a double-stranded break in the DNA by any means generated, we can use that other intact strand to help to repair that. But there is a difference, right? Because in this case, the double-stranded break in bacteria is only be repaired there in that case using the sister chromatids. If the only reason, if the sister chromatid presents, then only we can repair, otherwise not. Because for repairing of the double-stranded break, we rely on sister chromatids. On the other hand, if you are looking for the homologous recombination for other purposes, we rely on the non-sister chromatid process, okay, or non-sister chromatid swapping. So let's begin here the detailed stages of each of the process. So let's say these images are taken from the Watson molecular biology from Watson. Okay, that book is also uploaded in the drive. You can get them. So here, say at the beginning, we have a double-stranded break there. Okay, if there is not a break, but we still use the endonuclease to create this break, double-stranded break that is formed. After this double-stranded break, it will create that 3' overhang, right? How? This is the whole process. We know the enzyme that involved in this process is RecBCD, the RecBCD complex. So here we have a RecBCD complex loaded to one of this terminal. Remember, this particular image, we take one of these fragments and zoom in that fragment here. Okay, one of this fragment and zoom in there. At the end, we load that RecBCD at this end or at this end, whatever. We'll load RecBCD. And then RecBCD will start chewing that segment moving in this direction and chewing the segment. And it will start chewing the DNA segment until and unless it will reach a region called chi. Right? It's called crossover hotspot instigator sequences. Crossover hotspot instigator sequences or chi sequence that is present and found in the DNA. So once this REC BCD found this chi segment or chi sequence, it will undergo certain changes. What kind of changes? We don't know exactly. But a certain kind of changes. At that change, slowly, in some book I found that that this REC D released or something. But in other book I don't find that. So it's not a very clear idea what change exactly occur. But there are sometimes some kind of change occur. And after that, what will happen? The chewing activity from the 3' end almost stop. But the chewing activity from the 5' end continues. And even it is increased. Because see, at the beginning, the chewing from the 3' end was very fast. But now after it's reaching or upon reaching this chi segment, the chewing is already blocked from the 3' end. And it begins faster from the 5' end. And as a result, it generates an overhang where we have the chi segment at the last point and we have the 5' region there. This is the 3' structure like this. This is the structure that is formed in both of the double-stranded break contents. See, this is the chi side. And chi side region contains a sequence like GCT, GG, TGG. You don't need to remember, but just remember that there is a chi side chromosome hotspot indicator, crossover hotspot instigator sequence. That's it. So see, this chi side is very important for getting the recombination frequency values. As we are going closer to the chi side, the recombination frequency increases. See, slowly as we are going towards chi side, the recombination frequency increases. So a sequence or the gene sequence, if it is remained, I mean, if it is placed nearer to the chi side, there is a maximum chance of recombination. Okay, and as we are going away from chi side, the recombination frequency getting lower. Just remember that. Now, once that thing is done, once this overhang is generated, now the second step is the addition of REC-A proteins. So say this is a strand. This is the 3' overhang that is generated. On the other hand, this is the another strand. This is the other 3' overhang that is generated. Now lots of REC-A proteins will be brought together. And one REC-A protein will bind with 3 nucleotide sequences. Okay. So in that way, the REC-A will bind one after another to make a kind of single strand binding protein approach. Just like the SSB we've seen in case of DNA replication, this REC-A protein will cover that 3' overhang completely. Okay. And then this filament of REC-A protein has been made surrounding the single stranded DNA. And this is the scenario which prepares the single stranded 3' overhang of the DNA for the invasion to the other DNA. See, this is a molecular structure of REC-A and DNA content. The use of REC-A filament is not only driving that DNA to the intact DNA, but also to check the exact complementary base pairing of that strand with the intact DNA. Because remember, this is the red strand which invades the blue one. So, the only way red strand can pair with the blue one is to find the complementary region. We know that they have a very sequence similarity, right? They have slightly minute sequence change, but most of the sequence are kind of similar. So they will interact with each other and find some, definitely they will find some complementary region. And whenever they find a complementary region, those two strands will bind with each other, right? But the idea is how will they find the complementary region. The REC-A filament helps that invading DNA to find the complementary region with the existing intact DNA. How? Let's say here in the REC-A filament, there are two different regions. One is called the primary binding site, another one is called the secondary binding site. See, the secondary binding site binds with that intact DNA. Okay, and the primary binding site is the major binding site which attaches with the single-stranded DNA. Remember, this is a single-stranded DNA and Rake proteins cover that up. So, Rake protein interacts with the single-stranded DNA with the primary binding site. See, so this is a nucleotide from the single-stranded DNA which will be evading. Okay, and this is the site which will interact with the double-stranded intact DNA, the secondary binding site. So see, this is the double-stranded intact DNA interacting with that secondary binding site. Okay, and then what they do here in this case, slowly this Rake helps to break this bond between these two double-stranded DNA and check the complementary of this base with the single-stranded base. They check the complementary. See, they are checking for the complementary. They are checking for it. If they find the complementary nature for the rest of the, because remember, this is a single small part of the DNA only shown. Because the DNA is large and Rake is covering that whole single-stranded DNA. So, it can check throughout this DNA for this complementary base pairing. If they find the base pairing between the single-stranded DNA with one of the bases from the double-stranded DNA throughout the stretch of the DNA, that means they found the proper homology of the DNA. And then they will break this bond and bind that with the single-stranded DNA and properly place the single-stranded DNA there. This is how single-stranded DNA is placed with the hydrogen bonding with the intact double-stranded DNA, one of the strands of the double-stranded DNA. This is how it's done. They check for this complementarity. Whenever they find the complementary for too many sequences in the downstream, they help this attachment and then remove itself from the single-stranded DNA. Once the single-stranded DNA is properly placed with the help of complementarity, then Rake proteins will be removed. Rake proteins will be released outside. Okay. So see, the process is done. Rake proteins are released. So now what do we form? We form a branch point. Now what is the idea? Is to move that branch point. If you see here, once let's say we properly find that place there. After that, the idea is to extend this DNA. So, we will be slowly extending this DNA in this direction, as well as this fork is going to move and we are extending the DNA with the help of the polymerization reaction. And also while other strand, this strand will also invade in the same way and will interact with the strand and finally meet that strand. Okay. So, during this process, two different branch points will be generated. If you imagine, say, right, it will look something like this. Two different branch points will be generated. This is one, this is another, right? Two branch points. So once the branch points are generated, then the branch point migration is done. Then the slow movement of branch point. How? See here, let's say this branch point, this red DNA, this is from the branch point. This red DNA will move at this direction, replacing this double-stranded DNA. This is the green strand. It will replace the green strand and place this red strand there. So see, slowly the green strand is being replaced with the new pairing with the red strand. And it requires ATP hydrolysis as an energy source for driving this branch point migration. And for the movement of this branch point, we need proteins called RAV-AB. RAV-AB helps in this branch point migration and also we need the energy from the ATP hydrolysis. Okay, and once we move that until and unless we figure that out. Now the question is, we have one chromosome from mother origin and father origin. So there are certain genetic differences, certain nucleotide differences between those DNA. Because see, the red is a completely different DNA, the green is a different DNA. So, there are certain genetic differences, certain nucleotide differences between those two DNA. So, we find some differences there, right? But those differences are one or two nucleotides long, so that probably forms some kind of bubbles or stem loop structures there somewhere. But ultimately, most of the DNA are similar. With the help of the complementary nature, they pairs properly. Okay. See, this is the model of RAB-AB and how RAB-AB brings and forms the holiday junction. See, the RAB-AB will move them from one place to another place. Now, if you imagine one of these structures properly, see one of these structures, and just slowly turn it 180 degree. Just try to imagine this scenario. Just slowly drag one of these strand, turn it 180 degree. What the structure will form? What kind of structure it will form? Because see, here in this particular structure, these two DNA strands are linked by base pairs, okay, the bases. So if you rotate that one, what will we form? We form a structure like this. We form a structure like this. Right? And this type of structure is known as the holiday junction, where you'll see both of the DNA strands, right, both of the parental DNA strands as well as the recombinant type that is formed in the middle, right? So once this structure is formed, we see RAB A and RAB B plays a vital role. RAB A acts like a helicase pattern which will help to unwind the DNAs and moving them in a particular direction, where RAB B helps in the movement of this branch point, right? This is the function of RAB AB, and this is the molecular, this is the ball and stick drawing there, okay? The water filling model actually. So here, once this particular stage is reached where we form this holiday junction, then the final stage is to cleave that holiday junction, right? So see, if this is the holiday junction, we can cleave it two different ways. Once we can cleave it from this angle, or we can cleave it from this angle. These are the two ways that we can generate, by this angle or by this angle. So see, if we cleave them by this angle, we generate a different kind of DNA, and if we cleave it by this angle, we generate another kind of DNA. See, if we cleave it from this angle, what it will form? It will form one parental with the recombinant, again parental with recombinant. So both of them will be the recombinant type. If we cleave it by this XY angle, XY axis, if we cleave it by XY axis, try to imagine, if we cleave it by XY axis, it will generate this strand as well as this strand. See, this strand is also recombined, this is also recombined here. So both of the recombinant types. But if we cleave it by AB axis, what it will generate? See, again, recombinant with the parental, recombinant with parental, again recombinant types. But it will be more clear if you look at the schematics, how this process is done. So see, once this stage is reached, then what we do, we'll imply another protein, that is the RAB-C. We've seen the purpose of RAB-AB. Then we place RAB-C. RAB-C recruits itself in, and RAB-C acts as a dimer. Two RAB-C proteins are required, and RAB-C is a kind of endonuclease which will cleave from a particular region, and then you see gaps will be formed, nicks will be formed actually. See, it will look something like this, where we see a nick, and that nick will be sealed by DNA ligase letter. Okay. So RAB-C cleaves it, and the DNA ligase seals the nick. Now this image clears the understanding of holiday junction resolution. So say this is a scenario where we have gone through all the stages. Now ultimately, now we have, say this is one parental type, this is another parental type, and there is a recombinant type. Now remember, if the cleavage occurs at the same site, see, cleavage can possible in both the sites. From this one, I mean from this vertical axis, or it is possible from this horizontal axis, which is the point 2. 1 for the vertical axis, 2 for the horizontal axis. Now, if cleavage takes place in the same way, either both, because there are two branch points, if the cleavage takes place or the resolution takes place, both the point one way or the vertical way or both the horizontal way, in either way, cleavage at both point take place either vertical way or horizontal way, it will generate non-crossover products. Why? Because just imagine if it cleaves from here, and here, from here. So this is the cleavage that occurs. And what it will generate? It will generate one of the strand that will contain some new DNA segment, but the other strand remains parental. See, this strand remains parental, while this strand also remains parental. And we have 50-50 recombination here with the two other strands. So we call it a non-crossover products because one of the strands remain parental there. Either way, if both the cleavage occurs at point 1 or both the occurs at point 2. But if the cleavage occurs one at point 1, another at point 2. If this one point 1, this one point 2, or this one point 2, this one point 1, whatever. But different way, point 1 and point 2. Then both of the strands will be recombinant type. See, both of the strands are recombinant. Now it will be much more clear if you look at the animation. I'll attach an animation after this. I'll attach an animation with the email. You must go through that animation. It is a beautiful animation to help you understand the 3D model of this process. Well, you see, if we cleave from one from two and one from one, and then we resolve this process, we'll see both of the strands recombinant type, and we call them crossover products. If both the strands are recombinant, we call them crossover products because we call them the crossover works properly there. But on the other hand, if they are not recombined properly, one strand remains parental, we call them non-crossover products. So this is about the site homologous recombination process, okay? Now let's talk about the site-specific recombination. Homologous recombination relies on the process that two DNA sequences should have a homology between them. Whether it's an originate from mother or father, there is an homology present between the human chromosome or human DNA that we can use for the process of double-strand break repair, as well as the recombination is required for the movement and change and mixing of genetic material and shuffling of genetic material, okay, to increase the variation. But site-specific recombination is a different thing, where site-specific recombination works in a specific site of the genome only, specific site of the DNA only, right? And it also involves some specific site-specific recombinase enzymes, not like the homologous recombination. While homologous recombination relies on the sequence of the DNA, while site-specific recombination depends on the specific sequence for the binding of the site, and it starts with a specific site, it will not happen any other places than that specific site, okay? Site-specific recombination involves one enzyme only. That is a important task because that enzyme helps this process to work. And it could be tyrosine recombinase or serine recombinase. If you recapitulate the idea for the amino acid structure, you will see both of them, tyrosine as well as serine, they have a hydroxyl side chain. I mean, they have a larger side chain. For tyrosine, we have a ring, aromatic ring there also. But ultimately, they have a hydroxyl group at the end. In both of them, tyrosine as well as serine also have a hydroxyl there. So that hydroxyl, remember, wherever we see hydroxyl in biological system, you should be clear that that hydroxyl should act as a nucleophile. And the process will work like we see the cell splicing. That is exactly how the process will work. See here, this is the double-stranded DNA where exactly the site-specific recombination occurs. So the idea between the site-specific recombination that two double-stranded DNA strands are required, right? And we have that enzyme, let's say tyrosine recombinase enzyme. Tyrosine recombinase enzyme will create the pore, will create the double-stranded break in one of the DNA, right? And then it will hold on to that DNA and it will interact and arrange it with another DNA. We'll be seeing that in details. But see the process, the molecular process is that we have hydroxyl group there. Hydroxyl interact with the backbone of the DNA. It can attack the phosphate. As a result, the phosphodiester backbone can be cleaved. So now, with the help of this interaction, one of these tyrosine kinase can interact with this this backbone phosphate. So it creates the nick. And we have a 3' hydroxyl free. Now that 3' hydroxyl will interact with another strand of another DNA and do the same thing. Let's see. The process of this site-specific recombination known as conservative site-specific recombination or CSSR, where you have a conservative sequence specific present in the DNA. And we see a lot of site-specific recombination between the phage genome and bacterial genome. Because in the development of phage progeny, phage inject its DNA or genetic material inside the bacterial cell, and then that phage genome recombines with the bacterial genome and incorporate that phage genomic content to the bacterial genome, so that phage can use the bacterial replication strategy and transcription strategy to produce their own proteins. This is the typical way bacteriophage hijacks the process of the replication and transcription and translation in bacterial cell. Now see, before that I must say the details. Yeah, see, this is the process. In overview, the site specific recombination involves in a specific sequence. That sequence looks something like that, where we have these are the two sites. Say this is the DNA. We have two different sites for the binding of that tyrosine recombinase or serine recombinase, okay, and they are separated by a specific stretch of nucleotide sequences. Usually the sequence is TAGC. These are the four nucleotide sequences separating the two sites, the specific sites for this recombination. See, on all these cases, this is a true structure. So this is the two different DNA fragment, red and blue, which will take and which will participate in the site-specific recombination. Now see, site-specific recombinase binds with both of these DNA strands, right? And what they will do now, they will break them down in both of the strands and then swap the segment between them. Take the red one, join with the blue one. Take this blue one, join with the red one, right? This is the overview of how this process is done. See now, this is in detail process. See, this is the crossing over region, that four nucleotide separation. This has the recombination or recombinase recognition sites, RRS. Recombination recognition sequence or site, okay, where the recombinase protein will bind either serine recombinase or tyrosine recombinase. The process of site-specific recombination is extensively similar for both serine and tyrosine recombinase. There are slight differences between the serine recombinase and tyrosine recombinase. A slight difference. But mostly the process is same. In this case, we are seeing the serine recombinase in action. Serine recombinase joins in, and the examples of the name are R1 and R2 binds to the blue one, R3 and R4 bind to the red one. These are the two strands that will join. So now the serine recombinase 4, one from each strand bind with those DNA strands, okay. And then that hydroxyl attacks the backbone, cleaves the backbone, generation of 3' hydroxyl from both the ends. See, from both the ends, it's generated. After this is generated, the stage is that then this hydroxyl will attack this phosphate and cleave that phosphate out, and it will join this phosphodiester backbone between this red strand with this blue strand here, and this hydroxyl attacks this phosphate, do the same, so they will be joined. Similarly, on the other strand, this hydroxyl interacts with this phosphate, this hydroxyl interacts with this phosphate, crisscross interaction, and ultimately they will be joined. See, as this process involves nucleophilic attack only, and this is only making and breaking of bond, As at the very beginning, hydroxyl attack creates the phosphate bond linkage here. It stores some energy there, which will be used for the second stage for the hydroxyl attack to join. So, as we see at the very first stage, it creates the phosphate bond and retains some energy. In the second stage, it uses that energy to rejoin the DNA strands. So, we don't need any extra energy source for this process to happen. We don't need any ATP for the site-specific recombination. Okay? And then they will be resealed. And then the serine recombinase will leave the place. The process is very easy, right? It's not complicated like the homologous recombination. Now, this is the process of tyrosine recombination, where you see tyrosine recombinase have a slight difference. The whole molecular mechanism is the same. The hydrophilic attack and those things are the same. But tyrosine, in case of serine recombinase, we see four serine recombinase interact and they create the double-stranded break in both of the DNA. But in case of this tyrosine recombinase, they create only single-strand break in both of the strands. Then interact with those strands, create a holiday junction. Then use the other set of recombinase to create the break in other strand. Then join it together for creating another holiday junction. In serine recombinase, they cleave the strands, make them double-stranded breaks in both the strands and then rejoin. But in tyrosine recombinase, they cleave one strand at a time and join them and creating a holiday junction. Once the holiday junction is generated, then we cleave that holiday junction. And then we have the recombinant DNA. See, now this is a typical example of how a bacterial chromosome interacts with the Fas chromosome. Usually there are two specific sites in Fas. It is called ATTP and bacteria ATTB. So this ATTP site with ATTB site, they will come close to each other and the same way crisscross interaction take place by the help of recombinase, site-specific recombinase, and they will be joined. Now if a circular Fas DNA is joined with a linear bacterial chromosome, it becomes, the linear chromosome of bacteria becomes larger, right? Now if I go back a couple of slides, we have some images like this. This CSSR can be involved in different processes. Like say, if a circular insert is interacting with a site-specific recombination with a single strand, with a linear DNA, it will create a larger DNA strand, right? Similarly, if you have a larger DNA strand and both of these points are interacting, just like say, we have a larger DNA strand like this, and it interacts with itself like this. So what it will generate? It will generate a structure like this, right? Like this, deletion. Or it may cause an inversion where it will be cleaved and rotated 180 degree and place it back. And these things are important in the transposition. Transposition is another event of shuffling genetic material, placing genetic material in different locations of the genome, which also increases the variety. See, these are the different types of recombinations that are possible.